Rambler Metals and Mining is a junior mining company in the general mining sector, and it operates in very safe areas around the world in Canada and Newfoundland. Let's talk now to the President and Chief Executive, George Ogilvie. Welcome.
Thank you.
First of all, I want to get an idea of the history of the company, because it's quite an interesting story to be told here.
Yes, Rambler Metals and Mining listed on the AIM market in 2005 after we had acquired the Ming mine, which is a former producing copper gold mine in Bay Vert, Newfoundland. Following the listing in London, we subsequently listed on the TSXV in 2007. The Ming mine was in production between 1972 and 1982 and is an underground massive sulfide mine, and actually closed in 1982 when a property boundary was reached. The then owners consolidated Rambler was principally owned by the Irving Group, which is an oil and gas conglomerate in eastern Canada. And they reached the property boundary, and the mineral rights on the other side of the boundary were actually controlled back in 1982 by BP Selco, which was BP's mining division back in 1982. So subsequently, you had two oil and gas conglomerates who were fiercely competitive in that sector, actually trying to do a deal in a secondary sector, i.e. mining, that neither of them really cared about or understood. And as we subsequently know, they got out of that business. And subsequently, BP Selco would not allow Irving to mine through the property boundary. And subsequently, in 1982, Irving decided to walk away, and the mine closed and effectively remained dormant for some 25 years, until eventually acquired by Rambler back in 2004.
It's interesting though, because at the time when those mines were closed, the commodity prices for the commodities we're talking about were a lot lower than they are now. So there's an economic reason now to get this mine going, isn't there?
Well, absolutely. I mean, the first thing we did was we put drills on surface and drilled down plunge of the property boundary, and we found the massive sulfide obviously continued through this imaginary boundary. And we found very high grade deposits there of in excess of 3.5% copper, with 2.5 grams per ton of gold and 10 grams per ton of silver. Now, interestingly as well, 100 meters below the massive sulfide zone that was formerly mined, it was known that there was a large disseminated sulfide, much, much bigger tonnage, but lower grade. And we've been able to prove that through a JORC compliant or 43-101 compliant resource, that using $2.50 a pound of copper, we've got 10 million tons at 1.67% copper, giving us about 160,000 tons of copper metal actually sitting in the ground. Now, they knew that back in 1982, but with copper only being 35 cents a pound, it wasn't economical, and that was another reason why they decided to walk away. Of course, at today's prices of $4 a pound, or you know, $9,000 a ton, the footwall will be very attractive for Rambler once we get into production.
How much of what's in the share price at the moment is reflected in what you consider to be the potential for the mine? Because we're at 40 pence, you've got a market cap about £50 million. How much of what you described, what you anticipate is in the mine there to be mined, how much of it is already built into the share price?
Well, all that's built into the share price right now is really the first 6 years of production from the massive sulfides alone, which will produce in itself somewhere in the range of about 50,000 tons of copper metal, about 120,000 ounces of gold, and 400,000 ounces of silver. But everything that I describe with respect to the footwall is not built into the share price currently at the moment. And it's also important to realize that all the zones within Rambler are open in multiple directions, including at depth.
So what sort of potential is there then here that's unseen in the share price of Rambler at the moment?
Well, there's massive potential, and if I could just give you an example, just last week we put out a press release that we had broken through into an historical heading, which was reported that had visible gold. And indeed, once we broke through there, we found visible gold on the face, which we've subsequently taken a couple of rounds. The visible gold is still sitting there, and we've seen assays come back from a laboratory which are in the range of 7 to 10 ounces per ton, which is absolutely massive. So we're very focused at the moment on bringing the mine into production in August and September. So with the resources we have, we're focused on that. But certainly in the background, we think this huge opportunity for expanding the mine and maybe chasing these gold veinlets that exist.
What sort of potential upside is there in terms of monetary value?
Well, it's absolutely massive, because one round in a development heading with those type of grades in itself would generate about $500,000 at today's prices, and would cost less than $10,000 to actually mine that round. So the margins are phenomenal.
What are the risks here? It seems to me there's no political risk, obviously. It seems like there is just operational risk. Is that correct?
Yes. The risk that we have at the moment is pure execution risk with respect to the initial phase one six-year plan. The mine is currently under construction. We have all the permits. We did a financing last week, and currently our treasury sits now at £12 million. So we're well financed through to the end of the year. We currently envisage the mine coming into production August, September of this year. So really it's just pure execution risk on the ground.
And of that money you've raised and the money that's already in the bank, how much of it do you envisage using? And do you think you'll need more money to take you through to that first income from the potential of this mine?
We believe the money we've raised will take us through to first income, through the first cash cycle. There's several million dollars which would be invested in the remaining capital expenditures, which should actually cease in June, July of this year. The remaining monies will actually go into the operating expenses of the mine. So what we'll see is we'll be producing first concentrates, let's say, in September of this year. We'll see monthly operating costs of $2 to $2.5 million. And it'll only be in December or January of next year that we'll have a 5,000 ton lot of concentrate that will actually then go to the market. And at today's prices, that would be about $22 million in revenue. So the money principally helps us through that first cash cycle till we see revenue.
Is there any chance, do you think, if you've been taken over, could there be an offer out there, do you think, that might, for shareholders, be just too good to resist? Or do you see yourself persisting with this as a standalone company?
I would say at the end of the day, if we were to receive an offer, then obviously we would consider it. And if it were in the best interests of the shareholders, then obviously we would consider selling the company, because ultimately that's my job at the end of the day,
of course,
is to create the maximum value
for
the shareholders.
That's not plan A.
But it's not plan A. At the moment, we think that obviously the project and the company is significantly undervalued, and we would like to build the company up to a certain value when we think, no, it's, you know, an attractive, you know, asset for potentially somebody else out there in the marketplace.
Significantly undervalued. Good, that's a good place to finish. George, thanks indeed for joining us.
George
Ogilvie there, President and Chief Executive of Rambler Metals and Mining.
This film is for educational and leisure purposes only. Proactive Investors does not provide investment advice. The company is a publisher and is not registered with or authorized by the Financial Services Authority. Please refer to the full terms and conditions on the Proactive Investors website.